नमस्कार, समाचार दर्शन में आपका स्वागत है। समाचार दर्शन के आज के इस अंक में हम आपकी मुलाकात करा रहे हैं विश्व प्रसिद्ध आर्किटेक्ट क्रिस्टोफर बेनिंजर से। क्रिस्टोफर बेनिंजर आर्किटेक्ट के क्षेत्र में एक जाना माना नाम है। दुनिया भर के कई प्रोजेक्ट्स क्रिस्टोफर बेनिंजर ने पूरे किए हैं और इन प्रोजेक्ट्स में उन्हें कई इनाम भी मिल चुके हैं। तो आज हमारे साथ हैं जाने माने वास्तुविद आर्किटेक्ट श्री क्रिस्टोफर बेनिंजर। क्रिस्टोफर बेनिंजर जी, आपका बहुत बहुत स्वागत है।
हेलो, इट्स लवली टू बी हियर इन छत्तीसगढ़ एंड इट्स एक्साइटिंग फॉर मी बिकॉज आई विजिटेड मेनी कंट्रीज बट इट्स माय फर्स्ट विजिट हियर, सो इट्स अ न्यू थिंग फॉर मी।
क्रिस्टोफर जी, फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल यू टेल मी, यू आर एसोसिएटेड विद सो मेनी एड बैंक्स, वर्ल्ड बैंक and Asian Development Bank, and their project with the help of their aid. Yeah. So many projects are there in Chhattisgarh. So are you associated with these projects?
No, I'm not associated with the projects in Chhattisgarh.
Okay.
But I worked with them, and they're very, some of the early World Bank projects in India. For example, the housing sector project in Chennai. At that time it was Madras, no? Where we were doing housing for the poor. And when we studied the housing, I said, the housing that you're building is too expensive for the poor. They're building their own houses. So why don't we just make plots, small plots of land with water supply, sewage, storm drainage, and then let them build their own houses. So in that way, we built about 15,000 houses using World Bank funds. So World Bank funds can be used creatively.
Regarding this housing projects, we have so many housing projects in our Chhattisgarh, like there is a Atal Awas Yojana, there is other housing projects are also. So how do you see these housing projects, and how do you suggest some benefits to these housing projects so that they can be very successful?
See most of these housing projects are built on something called the supply concept.
Yeah.
That is, the government or some agency or NGO, they build houses according to their idea of what a low-cost house is, and then they try to get the lower economic sections to come in. I feel it should be on the demand side, where you actually facilitate people to build their own houses. See, people all over India are not using architects and engineers. They're not using the World Bank. They're building their own houses. So how do we facilitate people to build their own houses, which is what traditionally for thousands of years people have done in India? I think creating tenure to small plots of land. Let them buy a plot of land so the EMI will be less, because it's just a plot of land. It may be 400 square feet, but on that 400 square feet, they're very capable of building their own house. So I think the strategy is wrong. The strategy to supply houses as brick and concrete houses is wrong. Let people build their own houses.
Is it the same policy all over the world?
No. I think the first time it happened was in Chennai,
okay,
where we did it on a mass level.
So flexibility is a key of success of this housing project. So would you want to say that?
Yes, I want to say flexibility. And let me use a funny word, disjointed incrementalism. You see, if you take a loan for 30 years for 50,000, let's say a 10 lakh apartment, every month you have to make the same payment. But some month, if you're in the informal sector, you may not make any money. So after a couple of months, you may have to forfeit possession of your house then. But if it's disjointed, if it's a plot of land and you're building your own house, well, maybe 3 months you have no money. So you don't have to make payments then. And it's incrementally built according to your ability to pay. So putting things in a formal sector bank loan, it ties people down to monthly payments which may be beyond their capacity many times. So I think self-help, disjointed incrementalism, that's the way.
Yeah, that's very sure. And if we talk about the architecture, how do you see architecture in Chhattisgarh particular, and how do you see architecture for the students, for the person in India?
See, unfortunately, right from independence, I would say right from the colonial period, we started having Western models of what is a good building. The British came in and said a cottage, a bungalow is what you should live in, but nobody can afford to live in a cottage or bungalow.
Yeah, definitely.
They said, American planners said that you have plots, have a setback, have a minimum coverage of maybe 33% or 50%, and you build ground plus one maximum, and you have an FSM. That's not the way Delhi was built. That's not the way Bhopal was built. People share walls. They don't have setbacks. That makes for more efficiency in terms of sustainability, because the heat gain is less. There's a courtyard in the house. That's a public open space for the family. So I think we should look back at tradition and ask, how did people build just 200 years ago, 150 years ago, beautiful cities in India?
Yeah, definitely.
Why don't we learn from the past? Take two steps backward and three steps forward, and then we'll build better cities.
So definitely we have to go to our past. We have to see our past and how they make the houses so easily and so economically, right?
Right, I think so. I think the secret lies in our own past and our own history,
yeah.
Not in the history of America or in UK.
And secondly, we should not follow the West blindly.
No, I think if you look at the West over the last 70 years,
yeah.
They've actually made huge mistakes,
yeah.
Like made suburbs, which you can only live in a house if you own two automobiles.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So instead of building houses, they're selling automobiles. Then. And I don't think in a country like India, we should make any of our systems dependent on private transport. We need to link together housing strategies with transport strategies.
Definitely.
So if we put a metro stop, that metro stop, the land around it has a higher value. Those should be pedestrian, high density, housing should be around metro stop, and the lower density can be half a kilometer, a kilometer away. So we need to match up what we're doing in housing, the housing densities and FSI, with what we're doing in mass transport.
You talk about this mistake. Previously, we have so many concrete jungles, like our cities are concrete jungles. Now the architecture is radical turn, that is from concrete jungle to a green belt and green architecture. What should be the difference, and how do you see this difference from a concrete jungle to a green architecture?
See, concrete jungle is kind of a misnomer.
Yeah.
We can go lower density, lower rise, and we can have pedestrian-oriented, not vehicle-oriented. No? We can have nice material, local materials. See, every place in India, they want to build out of what? Concrete block, concrete structure, frame structure. No? So we should go back and say, well, what is the local material in Chhattisgarh? How did people build just 25 years ago in villages? No.
Okay.
Why can't we build like that now?
One thing, you have visited, you have worked with so many city planning projects. Right now, our state is very new. Chhattisgarh is very new. And we have a new capital, that is Atal Nagar, Naya Raipur. And this is Raipur. So there is a gap between Raipur and Naya Raipur. So how do you suggest about the perfect development of Naya Raipur and perfect development of Raipur?
I think that's what I call God question.
Yeah.
I would have to be God to give an answer to that. It's such a huge question. No? But I would say...
I just want some little points.
In Naya Raipur, why can't we have neighborhoods which are pedestrian? That is, you park your car on the edge in parking nodes around, and you walk into like a village now where there are no vehicles at all. You may have emergency lanes, you may have utility lanes for fixing things, but why can't we design neighborhoods like villages now, where everything is pedestrian? There are places, small parks, small chokes, where people can gather, children can play. Why bring automobiles in the middle of everything? So I think that's what I would say for the new capital.
For new Raipur.
That it can be clusters of pedestrian villages then.
Yeah, yeah.
Maybe ground plus two walk up. And it can be more like a traditional Indian village or town, which we've lost.
We don't need high-rise buildings?
I think the only place I would justify high-rise buildings, if you have a metro stop.
Okay.
So land values become very high.
Okay.
And young people can live there in studios and one-bedroom apartment. So I'd say if you have a metro stop, yes, put high rises, and on the ground level, put your entertainment, your fast turnover retail. Let there be like a little town with high rise housing around. But as you get away from the metro stops, then you can go down quickly in your heights and your FSM. So I think height of building depends on the value of land. Value of land depends on how you lay out your transfer.
Okay.
Because wherever there's a transport stop, there's huge opportunities. Those opportunities increase the value of land. So reflect that value of land. Put higher densities, higher buildings there. So to me, all these things are integrated.
Mensa, city development is not just a development of buildings. City development is a whole.
Yes, it's very holistic. And also, it's not an architect's dream.
Yeah.
It's a scientific system, like the organism of the body.